We just had 2 days ago Parashat Vaera, the second parasha in Sefer Shmot, the second book of Moses, what we call in English Exodus. When we started the previous parasha, we started speaking about the plagues, and this parasha begins in a very interesting way. Vayedaber Elokim el Moshe vayomer elav ani Hashem. Hashem comes to speak to Moshe. He said to him, I am God. Question is, thank you very much. Well, I'm looking so dumb to you that I don't know you, God. You speak to me. You're not my neighbor. If my neighbor come and say to me, hey, I'm Moshe. I'm Yitzchak. What would I say? What's the chidush? What's new about here? Right? So Hashem comes to him. Of course, Hashem spoke to him in a vision that it wasn't like from man to man. If it was Eliyahu Navi, which is an angel, he can come in a custom. He pretend he's a person. One day he can come as a poor person. One day he can come as in a different image. The angels can change their images as they wish, depend on their mission. But over here, there's no place to make mistakes, right? When Hashem came to Lavan, Lavan was a wicked person. He said to him, don't do anything until I inform you otherwise. He got the point. Hashem spoke to Bilam, the most wicked one that we can think of in the Torah. His wife was his donkey. What else you expect from a filthy person like this? Hashem spoke to him. He got the point. Hashem spoke la'avdil million alfei avdalot to Avraham Avinu. He got the point. Moshe Rabbeinu, it's already Hashem, already he had a revelation when Hashem spoke to him from the bush. So it's not the first time. If it was the first time, no, maybe surprised, you shocked. So Hashem is opening a conversation with you. It's not the first time. So what does it mean? Vayedaber Elokim el Moshe vayomer elav ani Hashem. The answer is, every time the Torah has the name of God, as you can see, it doesn't appear always the same name. It has different spelling. Sometimes it's the letter Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. Sometimes it's Shin, Daled, and then Yud. Sometimes it's Aleph and Lamed. Sometimes it's Aleph, Lamed, Hey, and Yud and Mems and ending Mem. So it's different names. What we say Elohim, because we cannot say Him the way it spells, because you're not allowed to pronounce the name of Hashem. This is one of the easiest sin to make with the hardest punishment. Just saying the name of God, what pleasure you had by that. If a person say Him instead of Elohim, instead of Elohim, he say Elo, and then he say Him instead of Kim, what did he say? It didn't mean any bad. He knows it's not allowed, but he just say it. That's a violation of the Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments is the top league of the sins. It's not just another sin. Forgot to wash your hands once a year. We're talking massive sins. Even the Lo Tignov, even you should not steal of the Ten Commandments, is not you should not steal money. It's much worse than money. You should not kidnap. That's what it means. Should not kidnap. He's speaking very, very severe sins here. It's falling in a category. It's the third commandment. The first one, I am the God who took you out of Egypt. Without that, there's no Torah. There's no Judaism. There's no nothing. How can you have a relationship with someone you don't know anything about him? I am the God that took you out of Egypt. Thank you. Nice to meet you. What's next? You should not have any other God but me. It's not enough just that you know me. You should know there's no one like me. That's the first two conditions in order for a person to have relationship with his creator. Without those two commandments, there's no opening. It's like trying to move into a house without getting the key or something. It's not really no beginning of relationship. What comes the first real commandments after those two? You should not say the name of God. Mainly what it means, it's on a false testimony, like you come to the Beit Din, you swear in the name of God for a lie, and things like that. That's really what it means. But with that, it has many other restrictions that applies to the same commandment. One of them is just to say the name of God for no reason. If you read in the Torah, you're allowed to say it. If you say the entire verse, you're allowed to say it. But if you just speak, you want to say, even some say that even the word God, G-O-D in English, even that is not allowed to be said. And it's not a coincidence that G-O-D in numeric value also give 26. The Goyim who invented this name, G-O-D, I don't know what was on their mind, why they decided to call God G-O-D. Where did this word come from? I don't really know the history of the Latin language or the English language. It probably is connected to something in Greek. I don't know the history of the languages. Someone who knows the history can tell you what word came from what word, and they go all the way back in history to the root, how the Goyim had a committee, and they decided to call a table, and all the other things. Once, if you remember, I had a lecture that showed in the Hebrew language, in the holy language, how many of the English words is actually taken from the language of the Torah, the Hebrew. It's actually taken from the Hebrew words. They made a slight change in a word, and then eventually with the accent it became a little bit further, and then it seems sometimes that there's no connection, but there's a lot of connection. But regardless, whatever they decide to call it G-O-D, what happened? It came to be 26, which is the name of God. Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey, 26. Name of God, 26. Also, we can see that from the beginning of the creation until we received the Torah was 26 generations. 10 generations from Adam to Noah, 10 generations from Noah to Abraham, then from Abraham to Moshe. It came to altogether 26 generations. Very interesting. Also, when you pray on Shabbat morning when we pray, from the beginning of the prayer until we reach the moment that we say, Ol Baruchu et Hashem Amvorach, the Chazan, the cantor, he says, Bless God, the Blessed One, right? And everyone say, Baruch Hashem Amvorach Leolam Vaed. Everyone answer, Bless God for eternity. That's really what it means. So, this actually is where the soul, a part of the soul who left the body at night when a person went to sleep, 1/60th of his existence, of his livelihood, you know, is going out of him. So it returns back when a person answers Baruch Hu Hashem Avorach. According to Kabbalah, that part goes back into his body, which means it's by his nostrils. But it will only enter back into the body after a person answers Baruch Hu Hashem Avorach. So you may say, what happened if a person is sick, he didn't go to shul? When you pray alone in the morning, you don't really say it because you need 10 people to say it. So that's why they have a special bright. It's a Mishnah that we say, Amar Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Akiva said, Chaya achat omedet barakia ushma Israel. There's one angel in heaven that the name of that angel is Israel. Israel. Ken chaya achat omedet barakia ushma Israel, vechakuk al mitzcha Israel, and on the forehead of this angel, it's written Israel. כן, וכל גדודי מעל העונים ואומרים, חיה אחת עומדת ברקיע ושמה ישראל, כן, this angel announced, ברכו את השם המבורך, וכל גדודי מעלה, all the millions of other angels, every day it's a repeat in heaven, they all answer, ברוך השם המבורך לעולם ועד. Since you're saying it's like a verse, it's a Mishnah, since you are saying it, it's like reading what happened in the upper world, but as you're reading it, you actually say, Baruchu et Hashem Amvorach, Bless God, the Blessed One. And then you also answer, Baruch Hashem Amvorach Leolam Vaed, because it's a part of this Mishnah, which is beautiful. So according to the Kabbalists, it helps for the Neshama to enter back into the body. This is what we say. Okay, so why do I say this now? Because from the beginning of the prayer until we say Baruchu, there's 541 verses. 541. Why 541? It's numeric value, Yitzchak plus Rivka. And from this Baruchu, there are 26 verses until you reach the Tefillat Shmona Esrei, which is entering the upper world, the highest world spiritually. It's called Olam Atzilut. It's the special core, the special world. There's four different worlds. It's the lowest one is the world where we live in. It has a lot of spirituality here, but also has a lot of materialism here. You have to do things. You manufacture things with your hands, with your body, with your mind. You actually have to do something. That's called Olam Asiya. Then you have on top of it, you have a world that's called Olam HaYetzira, the world of creation. What Yetzira means? Yetzira means that there is already a raw material and you form it into a special shape. You form it, you make it round, you make it triangle, you make it straight, whatever you want to do with the raw material. You take a rock and you make it as you wish. You take a piece of wood and you make a table. So the wood was already here, but you just turn it into something productive. That's called Olam HaYetzira. And then on top of it, you have Olam HaBriya. Briya means Yesh Me'ayin, which means there was really nothing besides God in space. And God created the material, everything that we have in all the billions of galaxies in our world, and the trees and the diamonds and the gold and the water, everything we have here, that's called Olam HaBriya. It was nothing, and in less than a second, everything was here already, right? That's called Olam HaBriya, so it's a higher world. And then, right after that, you have Olam HaAtzilut. Olam HaAtzilut means this is the highest, highest level, which is pure, pure, pure spirituality. Nothing to do with creation or anything like this. It's something that is above our understanding. So this Olam HaAtzilut. So when we pray in the morning, there's lots of secrets in the prayers of the Jewish prayers. By the Gentiles, there's no secrets. They don't know anything. They don't know the upper worlds. They don't know Kabbalah. They don't know anything. They only know that we want God to give us money and life and health and children and peace and whatever they want. So whatever they ask is an ordinary person who come to the doctor and say, help me, cure me, give me, or he comes to his father, lend me money, give me money, help me to open a business. You know, that's ordinary request. They also learn from us that you have to praise God, you have to be grateful, you have to talk to him, they learn all these things from us, so they design their own prayers, but they don't have one secret in their prayers, nothing. They don't have hidden codes, they don't have numeric values, they don't have separate worlds, they don't have no idea what it is, Bichlal. Have no idea. But really the main thing in our prayer, it's the secret. The secrets of the prayers, it's higher than the request. Like some people think, oh, I'm speaking to God, I'm talking, I'm blessing him, I'm praising him. That's very important, of course. But the secrets inside the prayers, some people would never know it in entire life. If they're not learning deeply the Torah, they can pray 7 years. They don't understand really what they are doing every day. They don't understand. So then just briefly, I have a whole lecture about the prayers. You can search in my website, the secrets of the prayers. You can listen an hour and a half to many of the secrets of the prayers. But just one thing, since we mentioned it. So the prayer is designed also in 4 different departments. The beginning of the prayers, after we say the blessing of the morning, the ordinary day of a Jew. He wakes up, male, female, first sentence, before he even washes his hands, even though there's bad spirits on the hands, because when a part of the soul leaves the body, the bad spirit is coming on the hands and also on the legs. We don't wash the legs because you cannot get the bad spirits out of the legs. That's why we don't touch the legs. If we touch the legs, we have to wash our hands. But the legs, there's no power to remove the bad spirit from the legs. That's why we don't touch the legs. We're very careful not to touch the legs. You touch the legs, you have to run and wash your hands. If you wash your legs when you dress, it's no problem. If you touch the actual flesh, then you need right away to wash your hands. So the interesting thing is that in the beginning, after we say the morning blessing, when the prayer begins, the first part, before we say the first Kaddish, it's the story of Avraham Avinu and the Akedah. Abraham takes his son Isaac. He is preparing him to sacrifice him as a sacrifice to God. All the things between Abraham and Isaac, this is all in this world. The Moriah mountain with the donkey. What's happening here? So this belongs to this world. It's Olam HaAsiya. Then right after that, we go to the sacrifices. All the different sacrifices, the daily sacrifices. Why? Because the prayers are replacement for the daily sacrifices who took place in the Holy Temple. Since we don't have the temple, And we cannot sacrifice any cows, any sheep, any goats. Sacrifices has also millions of secrets in it. It's all a matter of reincarnations of wicked people who died and God sent them back in the body of an animal, and now you slaughter it and you burn it and different parts go to different places. Millions of secrets in it. And the smoke and the smell, everything is very, very deep. So you see that the Torah put a very heavy weight on this thing of the sacrifices. Maybe half of the 613 commandments somehow connected to all the ceremonies of the Beit HaMikdash, which doesn't apply in the last 2,000 years since the Second Temple was destroyed. So the Torah, thank God, we had a way out since there's no opportunities anymore to sacrifice any animals. So the Torah says when there is no altar, there's no temple, we are paying the cows with our lips. Where does it say it? Uneshalma parim sfatenu. We'll pay the cows with our lips. So that's why the prayers are replacement for the sacrifices. So how does it go? So we go from Avraham Avinu in the story of the Akedah into the sacrifices, which is all slaughtering, burning, taking the skin off, building better. This is all things of this world. So everything, the entire part of the prayers, which is the lowest world, until we get to the first Kaddish. Then we say Kaddish. The Kaddish is a divider between the lowest world to the second lowest world, which is the world that is a little bit above. What is it, as we say? Olam HaYetzirah, the world of creation, but the material was already here. You just form it as you wish. So that's a higher level already. So what's going on? From now we're starting Odu LaHashem. We're starting all the Psukei DeZimra, all the songs, we're praising Hashem. The entire second part of the prayer is praising Hashem. All songs, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Even the Goyim use this word. Hallelujah means, Hallelujah means praise. Yah means God. That's one of his names, Yud and Hey, right? So Hallelujah, right, which means praise God. So the five songs from Psalms of King David, five different Hallelujah, you know, and the song of David, Vayevarech David, as David was praising Hashem. And then Az Yashir Moshe, it's another song of Moshe Rabbeinu after the Exodus of Egypt. So all the songs that praising Hashem, these legendary songs, are all in the second parts of the prayers. It's already a higher world. Now we're already praising Hashem with our mouth. It's not the hands anymore. Now we're going to a higher level. Then after that, we say Kaddish again. Right, and everyone say Baruch Hu, right? And everyone say Baruch Hashem. And from here until the Shmona Esrei, until we stand and we whisper, that part of the prayers, it's already Olam HaBriah. So he's speaking about the creation of the sun, the creation of the moon. That was really nothing. The creation of the world and the renewal of the world, that every day HaKadosh Baruch Hu renewed the world with his mercy. It wasn't a one-time creation. It's an endless creation who revive itself every second, every week. HaKadosh Baruch Hu review the creation and decide, do I want to go one more week or it's time to get it over with? It's constantly getting renewed. Just for you to understand, the earth is turning around 1,700 kilometers per hour. Because of that fact, day and night is 24 hours, exactly. 24 hours, 60 minutes every hour. Not a second more, not a second less. For thousands of years, it never missed a second, never added a second, never decreased a second. Otherwise, if it wouldn't be precise, right, to the tenth of a second, to a millionth of a second, then the watches had no value. Because every once in a while, you had to replace your watch and get a new one, and you would not know how to adjust it, because Earth sometimes go fast, sometimes go slow. We, as people, sometimes we have energy, we walk fast. Sometimes we tire, we walk slow. Same thing, everything you do, sometimes fast, sometimes slow. Imagine the world was a moody thing. One day is in a good mood, so it turns quick. So we got up in the morning, 2 hours later, night. Today is hyper. Then the next day, you say, okay, let's see what's going to be today. 50 hours, still sunny. Life had no value. You wouldn't know where to pray, when it's time for mincha, when you can circumcise the baby. You don't know. Maybe another minute from now it's going to be dark. Maybe another 5 hours it's going to be dark. You wouldn't know when Shabbat is. So the entire Torah would be dismissed. The Torah has no existence if time will not work properly. By the way, you should know the word Genesis, Bereshit, how it starts in the beginning. Bereshit means the creation of time. If somebody asks, what does it mean in the beginning? Before this world, in the beginning, before the world was created, there was no time. Because time only exists where material exists. Once material was created from nothing, there was nothing, it was only space. And up, now there is material. Everything you see here in this world, in less than a second, it exists now. That particular moment that material started to expand, that was the beginning of measuring time. The way we know time. Time have different aspects. And you go to upper worlds, it can receive a different aspect. Right now, we're speaking as we know. Time, 60 seconds in a minute, 60, this is entire creation of time. It's a part of the creation. If you miss it by 1 second, entire Judaism, the entire truth of the Torah will be eventually dismissed. So the third part of the prayer is Olam Abriya. It's called Yesh Me'ayin. It was nothing, and now everything is here. So this entire part, this 26 verses, as I told you, is all about creation and renewal of the creation. And then we go into the Tfilat Shmona Esrei, the actual prayers of Shmona Esrei. Shmona Esrei, if you can see, first of all the prayers you say loud. Shmona Esrei, everyone stand, and it's whispering, and it's you connecting express to the Creator for 5, 10 minutes, whatever it takes you, and you say the entire 19 blessings, should have been 18. Later they added one more because of the people who betrayed their own people. But this is the entire prayer. Now what we do, inside this prayer, we have the Kedusha. What we say, Kadosh, Kadosh, Kadosh. Where this part comes from? The prophet saw a vision of what happening in this world that I'm telling you, Olam Atzilut, the highest spiritual world. The prophet has a vision of all these choirs of angels, one on this side, one on the other side, and he described their images. They have all kinds of images, look like certain animals, a cow face, an eagle face, all kinds of things like this. And of course, we don't really understand the depth of his words. But one thing we know, that they all were praising and singing to God, the angels. And the angel, you have to understand, is different than us. Why? Because we have evil inclination. One day you're not in a mood to praise God. Your stocks are down today. You open your eyes, 7 a.m., below market. You're already losing thousands of dollars. You're not in a mood to pray today. Because most people, their love to Hashem is determined on how much He does for me, which is one of the biggest mistakes in life. People develop relationship with God by give and take. You give me, I'll give you. You don't give me, I'm not interested to give you. It should be the other way around. That's the biggest mistake. I'll give you, whether you give me, whether you don't give me, I am here to give you, which means you don't need anything from me. You're perfect with or without me. But I am giving you because you are like a mirror to me. It's a reflection. Whatever I give, I actually take. I give donation, it comes to me. I help someone, it will help my children. I help someone's marriage, it will help my marriage. I help someone's health, it will help my health. Everything measure for measure. Everything measure for measure. You know, I gotta tell you something. Even in the most stupid things in a creation, you can find the leadership and the supervision of Hashem. Even in a soccer game. A soccer game. You know, even a soccer game, which is 100% pure waste of time. Pure waste of time. If you run and do sport, fine. Sport is good. To do sport, but to sit and watch sport, it's total waste of time. Cannot find one thing productive in it. There's only one thing that can be productive. If you're a murderer or a drug dealer and you're robbing people on the street and now there's a good game, the world is a safer place for the next 3 hours until the game will be over. So for those people, it's something productive. Let them sit and watch sport all their life. Tie them with handcuffs to the television. May they all watch sport and not have time to rob and mug us on the street. All these robbers and whoever, you know. So, that, yeah, even that, it can help sometimes. Also in jails, that's what keeps them busy. They put big televisions over there. I know one guy, he was arrested. He was in jail for 46 days. He was supposed to go into prison for a long, long time. Why? He was one of the movers. You know the movers? The moving companies? I don't know how it is today, but 10 years ago, they used to be the biggest crooks. And you can never win against these crooks. Other crooks, you can fight against. The movers, there's no way to fight them. Why? Because they come, they estimate the job, they tell you how much it's going to be. And then they come, they pick up your entire house, they put everything on a truck. Once you're in their hand, they have collateral. They will never release it until they blackmail you as much as they want. So what do? So, okay, we got to take the truck now from Brooklyn to Chicago. No, fine, how much? $7,000. So they say, okay, you agree. Then by the time they pack the house, they say, okay, we have boxes, we have overtime, we needed two more guys, and it's fees and tolls. Oh, it became $12,000. So what? We signed a contract, $7,000. You gave me a receipt. I said, I'm sorry, sir, that's the price. No, it cannot be. Talk to my boss. Yes, it's all a system of crooks. You call the boss. Yeah, I'm very sorry, sir. We're very, very busy. Don't waste our time. You want your stuff? This is the price. You don't want the stuff? We're not bringing anything down from the truck. If you don't let us finish the job now, we'll take it to storage. We'll sue you. This, that. We'll charge you $150 a day for storage fee. They have their tricks. I'm like a mafia. What are you going to do? So what happened? They do it, and they do it, and they do it, until Hashem get tired of them. So what does he do? One time he make them do a job, and they don't know who the customer is. They see Mr. X, Mr. Y, whatever. They don't know who he is. Apparently, this guy was a truck driver with a group of movers, and the one that they're moving his house from one state to another, it's a federal judge, but they don't know. So when they arrive to his house, the judge said, they don't know the judge. He looks like a nerd, you know, person like this. What this person can do? He is the best candidate to trick. What is he going to do? He's not a gangster, doesn't have tattoos, doesn't walk with a gun. What is he going to do, this man? In his 60s, what can he do? He move, we'll give him one smack, we'll kill him. They're not afraid of people like this. It's bread for breakfast for them. But this judge, he did not argue too much. He put the FBI on them. One phone call. The next day, the FBI was recording them, tracking them, putting things in the trucks. For 1 year, recording everything. And one good thing happened to this guy, that while he was a crook and does what he does, it wasn't the boss. It was just getting percentage from what they steal. The more he steals for his bosses, the more percentage they give him. He started to wake up and became religious. Started to listen to lectures. Then he came to the yeshiva, and he came to my class in the yeshiva. So when he came to my class, I basically grinded his mind. And I got so much fear into his mind that he started to realize that it's time to wake up. So he really made tshuva. This guy really made tshuva. I said, wow, what a rasha is to be. I can't believe all my life this. So he made tshuva, but then his bosses got arrested. They took away all their money, all their real estate, everything they had, and they sent them to prison for 14 years. Now they were looking for him. But they don't know where he is. He's in yeshiva. Where are they going to find an Israeli guy who's not even legal here? I can find it. Look for him. If he was staying in yeshiva without leaving the yeshiva, they'll never catch him. Well, one day he decided to borrow a car and drive somewhere. And I don't know, he made a turn or red light. I don't know what it was. So the car pulled him over. He put his name on the computer. Oh, requested. Right away, arrested him. They put him in jail. 46 days. He was in jail with 50 people in one room, no bathroom, one bathroom in the middle of the room, no doors. Imagine the life over there. And everyone was praying for him because he really made tshuva. and some kind of a miracle happened, maybe it happened one time in the history of the United States, that they already made a deal with him. They didn't want to drag it, so they told him, you go to prison for 3 years if you admit. We'll make a deal with you. All you have to say to the judge that you admit, everything's fine. They took a lawyer, and the lawyer say, don't worry, it's all legal. Instead of going 14 years like your bosses, you're only going to go 3 years. After good behaving, in 2 years you'll be out. So he's standing over there, Friday afternoon, 3 hours before Shabbat, with his brown pajama. He stands over there. His English, I don't have to tell you his English. He know maybe 5 words in his entire vocabulary. So he stands over there by the judge, and the judge asks him, Mr. X, do you understand the deal you sign on? And the judge is talking and talking. He doesn't understand one word of what the judge does just say. And he's as a person with some temper, he started to get angry. So no one prepared me for the judge giving me all these speeches and this. So he said to the judge, no. The judge said, you confess? He didn't even know what he said. He said, no. He said, you understand? So the judge looks around. He looks at the lawyer. The lawyer goes like this. And this fool is standing over there. He said, no. Like this. Go, no. So the judge, listen what happened. The judge got so angry at the lawyers. So he said to them, I don't understand. You're telling me it's a deal. It's a plea bargain deal. You went through it. You explained it to the guy. What's going on here? Case dismissed. Like this. Case dismissed. You understand what happened here? Now he's standing. He doesn't understand that his case was dismissed. The religious people who sit in the crown telling him in Hebrew, get out, you fool. They send you home. He doesn't understand what's happening. So he goes outside. So they say, where are you going? They say, I can go. I say, no. We're calling immigration to come take you. The prosecution, they're going crazy. So they say, how can we get this guy? Let's call the immigration to take him. So they call up the immigration. So he's standing there for 2 or 3 hours outside waiting for the immigration to come, put him in jail. Something happened. The immigration don't show up. 20 minutes before Shabbat, one guy said, just get this guy out of here. I don't want to even see him. Take your stuff. They're giving him all his stuff. Goodbye. We have 1 minute to run before we change our mind. He runs to the street with his brown pajama. Doesn't have $1. 20 minutes before Shabbat. He's thinking to himself, I'm in downtown Brooklyn. Where will I go now? You know, we have a friend in Borough Park. Right away, pull a cab. He doesn't tell the cab he doesn't have money. So he said to the cab, go to this address quickly. Run. It's Shabbat. I'm religious. That. The guy gets to Brooklyn. Mama, Shabbat starting. He doesn't have clothes, nothing. He comes, he knocks down on the door. The person is already in shul with his sons. So his wife comes. She sees him like this. So what happens? So you have to lend me money. I got to pay the cab. Paid the cab. He walks in, and she looks at him. She says, you have clothes? He said, no. She said, no, I can't believe it. I just bought yesterday's suit, and I made a mistake in the size, I think. She said, I think it's going to fit you. She gets the suit. He puts the suit. You know, there's no cuffs. But since he's so tall, this guy, so he was perfect. He wore the suit. And that's how it is. He came back to the yeshiva, then he got married, and he have a kosher home, and everything worked out. He was supposed to be in prison, but he made tshuva, and Hashem showed him a big miracle. And now the question is, how did we get to that story? From the creation of the world, we got to the downtown Brooklyn jail. Only Hashem knows. Okay, so we go back. So when we stand in front of Hashem, it's not only requesting. It's called Olam HaAtzilut. The prophet described how the choirs of the angels are praising the name of Hashem. And that's what we call Kedusha. That's why we stand with our legs closed, like the angel has 1 foot. So both feet are attached. It looks like one. And then we go high like this because they fly high. So all these little things that we do, symbolizing really what this part of the prayer is together. So now, Yitzchak and Rivka is 515 plus 26 verses. It comes to 541. Numeric value, Israel. So the father of Israel and the mother of Israel, it's Yitzchak and Rivka. Jacob, his name was changed to Israel, right? So the founder of the nation of Israel, it's Yitzchak, Isaac, and Rebecca. Yitzchak and Rivka. So that's why we have them in a tefillah. B'fi yesharim tidbarar, v'titze tzadikim tidkadash. All these things that we say, if you look in the sidurim, it shows you Yud, Tzadik, Chet, Kuf, and Rivka in a line, which is the founder of the nation of Israel, 515 verses from the beginning to the Baruch Hu, and 26 extra verses, 26 generations from the creation of the world until we got the Torah. It's all connected. And that's why it's good to come to shul on time. Why? If you don't come to shul on time, you come and you just join the choir in the middle, so you skipped one or two worlds already. You skip a world, you skip the second world, you come right away. So I have a friend, he's a Kohen, who used to make a joke, a sad joke, that Baruch Hashem is a Kohen, that he finally comes to Birkat Kohanim. If not, he would come by the end of Musaf. So everyone say, where is Mr. Diz, Kohen? He say, what? Don't worry, he will show up. You already know the Shmona Esrei, it's 8 o'clock. By the time it's all finished, it's 8, the repeat is 8:10. 8:11, he already come, quickly takes off his shoes, he come, that's how he started his day. Until today, 15 years like this. To change habits is very difficult. So Hashem come to Moshe and say, Ani Hashem. I started to explain that every time Hashem appears in the Torah in the different letters, it's a different side of Hashem. The judge, the merciful, this is the kind, there's different kinds of Hashem, which means Hashem is appearing to us in different ways, depend on the situation. Sometimes it's a strict judgment. Sometimes it's a lot of mercy. So every time is Elohim, Aleph, Lamed, He, Yud, and Mem, that means Midat Adin, the judgment. If it's a pure Elohim in the Torah, it's judgment. If it's a pure Yud, He, Vav, and He, it's mercy. So Vaidaber Elohim el Moshe, usually it says Vaidaber Hashem el Moshe. Yud, He, Vav, and He, over here, Vaidaber Elohim. So Rashi explained why. Diber ito mishpat. Hashem is angry at him. Angry at him. Why? Al shikshal ledaber velomar lama areot al ha'am hazeh. If you remember the last verse on the previous parasha, he say, God, why you made the situation worse to this nation? Why did you send me to Paro? If you did not want to release them right away, why did you send me? So the question is, what was Moshe's complaint? God already told him, I'm going to make a show. Have some patience. I'm going to tighten the heart of Paro. I will not let him release you right away because I want to destroy Egypt. If he'll let you go right away in a minute, what's the point? There's no reason why to destroy them for what they did to you. Give me some time. Let him fight me. And then I'm going to give him the final knockout. So why Moshe is upset? I don't understand. You don't trust God in 2 or 3 weeks everything will work out? So because they started to scream to him, you and your messages from God, you're a messenger, from the minute you came and told us about this dream of salvation, our situation getting worse by the minute. So they started to blame him. So what was Moshe's complaint? Not why you're not hitting Paro right away, because he already knew it's not going to happen in the first and not in the second time. So what he's complaining about? The complaint was, why are you using me as a part of your plan and people throw words at me and people are rebelling now against me? People speaking bad to me, they complaining against me. Why you use me as your front? This is what he complained about. And for that, he got a big punishment later on. Because Hashem told him, when I say to Abraham, leave everything you have and go, he didn't make a beep. I gave him a son after 99 years. I told him, oh, here is the son I promise you. He will inherit you. Then the next day, I say to him, take him and sacrifice him. Kill him. Kill him. He didn't make a beep. Oh, Abraham had a good point. He could say to Hashem, I'm very sorry. If I'll kill him, you will be remembered in history as a liar God. That's what Avraham should have said to him. You told me that you're the God of justice. A word is a word. You promised me that I'm going to have a son. You promised me this son will inherit me. You told me to teach the goyim not to sacrifice their babies. You coming to me now and tell me to kill this son. It will be that everything you told me until now, it's a lie, and I won't do it. I don't want to turn you into a liar. He had a very good point. But he was more clever than us. We think we know a lot. We would probably say, I don't know, at least me, if Hashem would come and tell me, take your son after 99 years, finally give me a son, I would argue with him, like it's in a Gemara. Please, God, I'm sorry. In a nice way. Forgive me for asking. I don't understand you. Didn't you just tell me, you know, that this is the son who will inherit me? Now, if I'm going to kill him, all the lectures and the seminars that I gave to this goyim not to kill their babies, your entire leadership here is in jeopardy. So for you, for your Kiddush Hashem, how do you tell me to do such a thing? Please explain. And he was more clever. He knew with God you don't ask questions. You don't ask, you don't complain. It looks the opposite of what he said. You do, you become religious, you try, you give lots of charity. And what happened? Everything is the other way around. You cannot find somebody to marry. Business is not good. Problems. Everyone is against you. All your friend is turning their back to you. Wow, since I became religious, look at my life now. Look how it used to be. I used to go here. I used to be Mr. Big Shot. Everyone around me, you know, vacations, making millions, stealing here, stealing there. The bank account is growing by the minute. Now, all of a sudden, what's going on? Not one thing I feel I got. That's how people talk. So the answer is, if a person became religious in his physical, materialistic life becoming better, that's a very good reason to worry about. Very good reason why. It doesn't make sense. Up to now, you make millions of sins, and you did not pay for one. God was still watching you to see. He's giving you still some time. Your punishments are on hold. Now you finally realize what you're living for. You finally stop to sin. You finally started to do good things. You finally regret your sins. You're not repeating them. You're learning Torah. You're working on your personality. And now you're going to make millions? So when are you going to pay for those sins? Payment is a payment. Bill is a bill. Even if you're the son of the president of America, still have to pay. You owe money to the government, you pay. Obama is my father. Very sorry, a law is the law. You have to pay. So, yes, Hashem is very happy from you, but you have a very, very large bill to pay. So what does Hashem do? He gives it to you in installment, not in one shot. If he gives it to you in one shot, you crash and you never move anymore. Little by little, the car is damaged. Investigation, penalty, 10 tickets every month. All kinds of things. The landlord, you have to move. Lots of little problems. Why, instead of giving it to you in one shot, he gives it to you little by little. And then slowly, slowly cleans you out in a period of 10, 20, 30 years. And then you come up crystal clean, pure diamond. Then you say, wow, how lucky I am. Then your friend, who was celebrating, he's full of spiritual stains. He come in front of Hashem. He has a huge list to pay for. That's why we say, tzochek mi shetzochek acharon. Doesn't matter who's laughing here. This world is a blink of the eye. Before you realize, it's over. Who's going to laugh in the end, which means forever, that's what's important. Who's laughing here? It's all nonsense. What you eat, you ate good, you didn't eat good. And an hour later, nobody remember what he ate. You have a house, you don't have a house. 30, 40 years in history, in billions of years, it's not even a drop. It's like comparing your 70 years of life, take 1 second out. You care what happened in that second? 1 second! 1 second life wasn't great. The air condition didn't work. 1 second. 1 second was too hot. 1 second was freezing. 1 second, I don't know, man, your wallet fell on the floor. One smack you got, that's it, your entire life. You care? The rest of the life was paradise. 1 second was bad from 70 or 80 years. This is how life compared to your eternity. 70, 80, 90 years of non-stop suffering When the soul comes out of the body, looking back in this life will be like one more blink of your eye. That's it, and it's over. Chazal say. The sages this, comparing this life, keherefayin. Herefayin means the 1 second that the eye needs to rest. That's why it blink, and then it reopens, and you don't even realize that you blink. Nobody realized. You know a person that can tell you how many times a minute he blink? Nobody knows. What do you mean? 4 years you're blinking and you don't know how many times you blink? How can it be? It's so quick that no one pays attention to it. That's how this world's going to be. So Hashem comes to Moshe and complains to him. He says, I'm the God, ne'eman leshalem sachar, faithful to pay rewards for those who are serving and following my instructions. I did not send you for free. No one works for me for free. I'm very generous payer. I'm paying a lot. But I pay in my own timing. 60 days credit, 90 days credit, 90 years credit. Depend. But don't worry. Even when we wait for your reward, even for the waiting, you're also going to get a reward. Why? Because this trial period that you're waiting for the reward and it's still not coming, all these years, you still are being tested in the most important thing in life. What is it? Faith. Faith and confidence in God. So the fact that your reward did not come 5 years, 10 years, 40 years from the time you did this great mitzvah, you don't see that God ever gave it to you. So all these years, you have no questions. I'm not worried. The wire was sent already to my Olam Haba. What's the problem? I'll give you an example. If you're dealing in business with lots of clients, one client is a shady client. Sometimes his wire going through, 4 or 5 times they don't go through. And then you have one customer, 30 years you're dealing with him. Every day, say, by 2 o'clock you have the wire, it was always there. After 30 years, you send him merchandise, and he say, I wire the money. Do you go and check in your computer if the money is there or no? You know 100%, 5,000 times it was always there. It's no point of checking anymore, waste of time. But the one who is shady, right away you want to check, knowing probably it's not there. So this trust is built on knowing who you're dealing with. When you know who you deal with, then you know how much to trust him. Now, when you know you're dealing with a creator of the world who made such a beautiful place for you and reviving you and sending you everything you need and you owe him so much, what reason you have not to trust him? If he had a group, a party that he runs to the Israeli election now, you know, politicians, even the ones who are honest, once they go into politics, they become corrupted. And I say to someone today on the phone, you can take the most righteous person, you put him in a circus called the Israeli Knesset or the United States Congress. You come after 1 month, they will become very corrupted. Why? You cannot sit with 300 corrupted people or 120 corrupted people who are very, very experienced with corruptions over there, 10, 20, 40 years already there. Put him with all these wolves, this little sheep, this little goat, and expect he's going to stay a goat. No. Why? The tests are too hard to pass. Too hard. Take a poor person, he gets elected, you put him in the government, all of a sudden, $10 million in his hand, $5 million, $2 million, budgets, he decides where the money will go. People begin to make him offers. Listen, look where you live. Your children have no future. What do you care? Who's going to serve the government? This company or this company? You have to choose one of the five. We give a decent offer, and we'll give you $1 million in an offshore account. What do you care? Anyway, someone has to do the job. Go find a person, one person that will be able to say no. It's a very hard test. So what's the solution? Not to go to politics. I don't go to a place I know I'm going to collapse there. I don't go to a bar in Manhattan. I don't go to a disco in Manhattan. I know once I'm going to be there, that's it. I'm finished. Once I'm there, I'm finished. The idea is not to go in. I know I don't want to try drugs one time in my life. Am I curious to know what it feels? Very. How many years I'm curious? 30 years. Did I ever touch it once? Never. Did I ever touch a cigarette once in my life? One time to try? Never. Why? I know there are certain fields that once you walk in, you may never come out. I do not want to walk into these aisles. That's all. That's the rule. That's what the Torah teach. Don't be a hero. You know your limitation. You know you're a thief. Don't ask to be a supervisor when it comes to money. You know you're not going to resist the temptation. You know you're a humanizer. Don't ask to be a hairstylist or a gynecologist all day with women. Do us a favor. Find a different job. Go teach the kids how to play baseball. Don't go to a place that you're weak. If you're strong, if you can work with your evil inclination, you control him. It's a different story. But how many people win against their evil inclination? You know one person today? You know, show me one person in the street. This is a righteous man. I always like to give this example that the Gemara said there are two ways. One full of women, short way, 100 yards. Shortcut, full of women. And the other one, 500 yards, no women. And a person is in a rush. So he wants to cut from the shortcut. But he sees a lot of women over there. He knows he's not allowed to start staring at the women on the street. It's not what the Torah allowed. So he's thinking to himself, I know it's not allowed. What's the question? I'm going to close my eyes and go. I'll stare at the floor. 1 minute, I'll cut. I'll save myself 10 minutes walk. So he walked through this aisle, and what happened? He did not look, and he made it. He did not see one girl. Now, if we put a candy camera on this guy, he doesn't know. If he knew we're watching him, of course he's going to be a holy man. Oh, he's going to put a mask, he's going to have someone to hold his hand, he's going to put the whole show, because he knows people will watch it on television tomorrow. But if he doesn't know, it's a candy camera. He doesn't know it's a camera who follows him. And he did not see. By the time he crossed that street, what would happen? Everyone would come. Surprise. The media, pictures. The new Baba came to town. 500 people standing online. Give us a bracha, Rabbi. You're the most holy rabbi in the world. You walked here, 500 girls. You didn't look at one of them. Come on. You have to be a holy man. So everyone stands, brings their children, Rabbi, give him bracha, give him that. What does the Torah say? He's a total wicked person. Shocking, huh? Totally wicked. Why? He passed the test that 99% of the men would not pass. Why wicked? He's a hero. For the test that he passed, God will reward him. Don't worry. Everyone gets what they deserve. We are now talking about the negative side of his choice. What is it? That he did not hesitate to put himself in a dangerous field. Mines are all over. And he was willing to take a risk, maybe I'll blow up. In the end, he did not blow up. But that's a fool. That's a fool. Why? A smart person doesn't go into a dangerous area. 4 times you make it, the 5th time you fail. The one you fail will destroy you. That's it. Like in everything else in life. So the person that knows limitation, what's over there, I don't go. Well, Rabbi, it's really nothing. It's kosher. Kosher singles, if there is such a thing. Kosher singles. It's only kosher singles, Rabbi. Kosher singles, the next thing this happened, next thing that. Stories, tons of stories. You know, so Hashem said to Moshe here something very interesting. He said like this. He said, I'm faithful to keep my words as I promised to the fathers, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. I am God who is faithful to pay my obligations, my promises, also the punishments. I am the God, when I say something, I keep it always. Whether it's going to be now, whether it's going to be tomorrow, whether it's going to be in 500 years, it happens for sure. It will happen for sure. There's no doubt if it will happen or not. The reward and the punishment will happen for sure. The advantage is that the punishment doesn't have to come. If we make tshuva, if we make repentance, we can erase it. But the reward is guaranteed already. So it says like this. I promise promises And all of them I say, I am Shin, Daled, and Yud. That's the name of God that symbolizes I am the faithful payer. I'm paying as I promised. Remember, Shin, Daled, and Yud, this is what we have on the mezuzah. Shin, Daled, and Yud. That's symbolizing that Hashem is faithful to pay his reward to the ones who are righteous and listens to him. Then, he said, "Ubishmi lo nodati lahem." Not everyone understands the different names of me. That's, by the way, confusing the goyim a lot. The goyim that comes to interpret the Torah to their language, they don't know. They don't have oral Torah. They don't know what the words mean. They try to translate it literally. And when you try to translate a holy, divine book like this literally, almost in every word you made a mistake. Not only the goyim, the Israeli communists that came to revive the Hebrew language, they wanted to make a national language for the Jewish people who came from all the exile. Some were speaking Yiddish, some were speaking Arabic. Everyone came with his own language, Ladino, Spaniol, this, Russian, all kinds of languages. So they said, we cannot have a country like in New York. Every other person speaks a different language. Yeah, excuse me, sir, por favor, amigo, yeah, everyone, Chinese guy, this, Italian, everyone speaks different language, international place. So we want to make an official language. So they wanted to make a Hebrew language, but since they were so ignorant, Eliezer ben Yehuda, first of all, he was a very wicked person. He was a very anti-religious person. He was fighting against the rabbi constantly. He made a newspaper called Atzvi and was constantly speaking Lashon Hara against the rabbis of the generation. Why? Because the rabbi put him on a ban. And he translated words from the Torah completely wrong. It could be two possibilities. One, that he was totally ignorant and didn't have even the minimum skills necessary. Second was that he did it on purpose, which he took words from the Torah and on purpose in the mother language, he translated them the opposite, to mess the language of the Torah learners. Let them get used to the new Hebrew. And today when we speak the modern Hebrew, many Israelis, they think one word means this, and actually according to the Torah, it means the opposite. Hundreds of words like this. And it's very hard because even the professor in a Hebrew university doesn't know it. You only know it if you know the Lashon Kodesh. It's a whole profession by itself. You can be a big rabbi. You can know lots of laws. You can know Gemara. You can give beautiful speeches, but you're not an expert in ancient Hebrew, what we call the Lashon HaKodesh. You're not going to know it. Even you will speak with mistakes. Not knowing all your life, you're saying words that comes from the Hebrew, modern Hebrew, when in reality, according to the Torah, it's the opposite of what you said. It's very interesting. I have a book that I review a few pages already. It brings you words. What does the Torah mean, or the Gemara, and what does it mean in a modern Hebrew? You get the shock of your life. Wow, it's like the opposite. Or different meanings. It's very interesting. So, you have to understand that this is a very complicated language. Why? Because this is a divine language. And every word is never going to be the same like other words. There's no two words that have the same meaning. You don't find in a holy language two words that have the same meaning. Like in English, you have many words that you can use, and it's the same thing, right? But in Hebrew, every word has something unique about it. The fact that most people don't know the differences doesn't mean there's no difference. Every word is something unique about it. So Hashem said to Moshe, I took you out of the slavery of Egypt. I release you. I took you to be my nation. I will. He's speaking that that's what's going to happen. I'm going to take you out of their heavy hands, their heavy arms. I will bring you to the land as I promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I will inherit the land to you. And then Moshe comes to pass the message and no one is listening. Why? No one is listening. Why? Mikotzer ruach u'me'avodah kasha. What do we learn from here? That when a person is distressed, is working, is business on his head, he doesn't have time and patience to listen to the word of God. Until today, it's exactly the same. Look at people that are so busy in their business, in their career. You speak to them words of Torah, it's like speaking to the wall. Not one word penetrate. Why? Their entire mind is occupied with their nonsense, with their addiction, which is work. Like they say in America, workaholic. Their addiction to money and to success and to achieve something, they are so designated to this nonsense that even when you talk to them something, that in every other time, if they have time, it would make perfect sense for them. They are blocked. Their mind is occupied, one thing, business. He doesn't see anything, see $100 bills in front of his eyes. Nothing else. There's nothing to, it's not impossible to talk to him. So what's the solution? How you talk to a person like this? There's only one way. The only way to talk to him is to offer him money, to bribe him. What's his dream? Money? Okay, how much you make a day? $500 a day. Okay, here is $500, take a day off. Not always it's gonna work. Sometimes it's the addiction to the job. But take $500, today you don't work. Today you have a different job. You sit and watch DVDs all day. That's your job today. You don't work. You give him money, his dream doesn't get affected, maybe he would listen. If it won't happen, you know when he's gonna listen? When he feel pain somewhere in his body, and he comes to the doctor, and the doctor say, oh, I'm afraid that maybe it's a cancer, or maybe it's this, give him some name, right away he begins to get scared. What about my dream? I have a whole dream. So right away, he remember, where are you, God? All of a sudden, he becomes religious. In his mentality, he already say, wow, God, if you save me, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Where were you until now? People try to talk to you, I'm not interested. Life is in danger. All of a sudden, where is the rabbi? Rabbi, can you come change the mezuzot? Can you come make a lecture in my house? Like I always say, in a hospital, everyone become religious. Everyone become religious. The biggest atheist, tell him that they suspect you have cancer. Between him and himself, when he's alone in a room, he's going to start speaking to God. If you dare, even Menashe, the Gemara gives an example for Menashe. 40, 50, 60 years, he put idols all over the land. Everything he was doing to get God as angry as possible. When he saw that all his idols don't help him, what did he start? Started to beg God to save him. Why? That's it. There's no more time for ego. I want to tell you something about ego. He used to be a big rabbi. His name Rabbi Akiva Iger. One of the greatest brains in our history. And of course, he knew the entire Talmud, which is 2,711 pages, with thousands of topics, big arguments, philosophical arguments, very, very complicated. You gotta have a very sharp brain to understand one of them. Forget about thousands of them. One of them fully, you have to be a genius. Most of the Gemara learners don't even understand 10% of the depth of the topics that they learn in a Gemara. They can give a beautiful speech about it, but they don't understand how deep it goes. What's the proof? I can give you from experience. First time you learn it, after 2 hours, let's say, you feel that the whole page is sitting in your brain. You understand what's going on, what's the question, what's the answer, this. Then you learn it tomorrow again. And the second time, it looks completely different than the first time. Then the next day you learn again, and you're now discovering things that you didn't realize before. By the fourth time, you begin to realize how much you didn't understand. How far it goes. Oh, now I understand this. I didn't pay attention to this word. Changed the entire thing now. It's so deep. Now multiplied by thousands of different topics. Very, very, it's endless. Endless. So he knew the entire Talmud by heart. Think about it, what a brain he had. Only 150 years ago he lived. That's it, five generations ago. How do you know he knew the whole Talmud by heart? After he passed away, they opened his Gemarot. Every topic he learned, he wrote on the side how many times it appears in the entire Talmud and where. And he didn't have a search engine. There was no Google yet. No computers. So then you come to the computer, you put a word. Computer will search how many times this word appeared in the Torah. How many times it's in the Talmud. Easy job. Computer in 1 second tells you what would take you 7 years to figure by yourself. But he had it in his head. Why am I telling you about it? He had a son. His son was Rav Shlomo Iger. Also a big chacham. One time he went to visit his son in yeshiva. Son was learning in yeshiva. And he came to visit his son. His son was learning by the Hasidim. In yeshiva of Hasidim. In Kotsk. There's a city, I think it's in Poland, Kotsk. When he walked into the Bet Midrash, when he walked into the yeshiva, he saw that everyone is around one guy, one teenager there, 17 years old, 18 years old. So he's around, everyone is around him. So he asked his son, what's the skills of this guy? Everyone is around his chair, around his table. Is he chacham? Is he a big talmid chacham? So he said, no. His son said, no, average. He said, is he rich? He said, no. He said, is he Baal Yechus? He come from important family of big Talmidei Chachamim, rabbis. He said, also no. So he said to him, in that case, what's his skill? What's special about him? So he said to him, he's humble. He's anav. Anav means down to earth, humbled. So he said to him, I don't get it. If he's not smart, if he's not rich, if he doesn't come from the important family, what reason he has to brag? He has to be humble. What's special about it? A person has no skills whatsoever. You're rich? No. You're smart? No. Your father is an important man? No. You're handsome? No. So what are you? Nothing. I'm humbled. Thank you very much that you humbled, mister. Well, imagine somebody like this is bragging. Doesn't make sense. So he didn't understand why they're impressed by him. What does he have to show? He has to be humbled. Him ken mai ma'alato. Amar lo anav, he's humbled. Amar lo im en bo klum. Pshita shi anav. He has to be humbled. Val ma yesh lo litgaot. But when they came to the Rebbe from Kotsk, he was in charge of that yeshiva, and he said the legend, Rabbi Akiva Iger, came to the yeshiva, and he saw us around this kid. He didn't understand why we are impressed that he's humbled. So he said, I don't really understand the rabbi. Why he was surprised, he said, listen good. He said, Adrabba, the opposite. Because he have nothing, he has a stronger desire to brag. Why? The fools, the empty people, always think that they are the greatest. The smarter you become, you realize that you are nothing. If you don't have even 1% knowledge, you think you are the greatest in the world. That's what's happening today in today's generation. Someone comes, he learned 2-3 years, already knows how to talk, knows already how to write certain things. The next day he goes against the biggest rabbi in the world, argue with him, fight with him, bring the media, all kinds of things that are happening today. Nobody knows to put themselves where they belong. That's why, when a person has nothing, he has bigger drive to show off that I'm the best. That's called Istera Belagina Kishkishkaria. One coin in a box makes a lot of noise. The box full of $100 bills, no noise. No noise. One penny, how much noise it makes. Sometimes you come to the yeshiva, you have people who learn 20 years. Then you have a guy 2 weeks in the yeshiva. Check, see if I'm right or wrong. People who learn 10 years, 5 years, 15 years, 20 years. Somebody asks a question, they're all thinking. He's 2 weeks in yeshiva, doesn't know how to hold the pen yet. Like a baby, right away jump. Oh, that's because of this. You don't see people 20 years are here, they're thinking. I guess it's a little bit deeper. Why? Because a beginner doesn't understand what a loser he is yet. In 5 years he will understand. Remember what I said, it's a very important thing in life. Just when you think you're the smartest, think again. Think again and you find out you're just one piece of dust flying in the middle of nowhere. The world is perfect without you, don't worry. And if Hashem would need to get rid of you, He has plenty of people He can replace you with. You have plenty of substitutes, even though you think that the world is standing on your shoulder. That's what made Moshe Rabbeinu the leader of the most important nation in history. Not his speech, not his beauty, not his money, nothing. Only one thing. He knew that he's down to earth. He was a smart man, but he kept himself in the lowest level. He didn't know how to be proud, how to feel proud. It's not one thing that some people are humbled in their mouth. You never hear them talking about themselves. But inside their heart, they are fuming when they don't get the respect they expect. But they know, I'm not going to be that fool showing everyone that I'm getting angry, that they're not respecting me. It's going to ruin my career if I'm going to show that I'm getting angry that they put me to sit over here, or they don't give me this, or they don't give me the respect, or they don't kiss my hand. It's going to drive me crazy. But I have to hide it. Otherwise, everyone will hate me. But what's in his heart is dying. But the right thing is to get to a situation that you don't even feel inside a problem. Like I always tell this story, that the biggest chacham in this generation who lived, and the biggest Kabbalist in the world, Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul, got on a bus in Yerushalayim, and the driver did not know him because he didn't have any custom. He didn't have any special people who hold his hand. He was just walking as an ordinary person in the street, buying vegetables, eggplant, like this, in a supermarket, getting on a bus. He could have a driver. They begged him to have a driver. Driver, the government will pay. Religious people have budgets. He didn't want. He get on a bus, sit on a bus. So when he got on the bus, the driver didn't know who he is. You see, an ordinary religious person. So he threw a towel to him. Hey, buddy, can you clean the mirror for me? The bus. I was standing and cleaning the mirror, and he wasn't even upset. Smiling, giving him back the towel. So if it would happen to one of us, no, what are we going to do? Shame on you. You're giving me the towel to clean your mirror. You won't finish the year. You won't finish this year. By Rosh Hashanah, I'll be dead. No, you only make yourself look like a fool. But, so you put a show. You pretend you're an anav. You pretend you're humble. But inside, the fire is coming out of your ears. It's hard to hold it in. Why? I am the real big shot, the biggest person in the world, and he's giving me a towel like I'm working in a car wash here. I came from Zambia yesterday. I'm drying cars here in Little Neck car wash here. What's going on here? Probably this driver wouldn't make it another block if he would get angry at him. But he was really, really, really down to earth. Didn't feel offended. Why? That's a hero. Hakoveshet Yitzro. Occupy his evil inclination. Doesn't let him make a beep. Sit and be quiet. This little Satan inside of us, the goal is to make him mute. Sit and don't move. That's very hard. Without Torah, it's very hard. Impossible. Million psychologists and psychiatrists will not do what the Torah can do. Most of them, if they don't connect to the Torah, they will give you such bad advice that will probably mess your life 10 times worse and blackmail all your money also. You're still going to pay for the bad advice. Why? How can they give you good advice? They're not connected to the truth of God. They don't even know what they live for. Take an average secular psychiatrist or psychologist or any social service person who his job is to evaluate family, marriage, children, danger to the children, all these specialists who come and decide life and death, future of people. Ask one of them if he knows what's the purpose of his life. I put my life on the line. One of them would not know. Never, not to talk about judges in the Supreme Court that they don't know what we live for. Him and his boyfriend just got married yesterday, and he's going to decide if I'm going to live or if I die. You understand that according to the Torah, he was supposed to be hanged already 20 years ago, and Hashem is still waiting for him to make repentance. He's going to decide what city will be given to the Palestinian, what city will stay in Israel, who's going to go to jail for the rest of his life, and which kid will go with his father or will go with his mother. This hypocrite murderer that sits there in a chair and wear the black kilt, and he decides. Ask him, what are you living for, Mr. Yohaner? What are you living for? Do you know the purpose of life? What? What's the purpose of life? Control? Money? Marriage? He doesn't know. If a person doesn't know the purpose of life, how can he be a judge? A judge is like a little god. Judge has power, has divine powers in his hand. The world gave him power. The world gave him power. You know what it means to be a judge? First of all, you have to be a fool to want to be a judge. Excuse my language. Even in religion. It's such a risk. It's such a danger. One mistake. In 30 years, you sit in a court and you murder a family for eternity. One mistake. You didn't read carefully. You're lazy. You skipped a page. You didn't review it 5 times before you make your verdict. And an innocent person will sit in jail 30 years. And his children will become drug addicts. And they'll murder and they rape and they have children in jails. It's all because of one mistake that you made. Even if you judge fairly 20 years, you made one mistake in the end, you are finished. You know what responsibility it is? You gotta be brave. So why people want to be judges? One reason only. The desire for honor and for respect is so strong that they're willing to do anything to get to this level that people will bow down to them. What's the proof? Haman. Millions of people bow down to him. Big deal. So one rabbi doesn't bow down to you. Pretend you don't see. From that rabbi, his entire decision came. He wants to kill now all the Jews. Okay, you want to kill him? Why you want to kill the whole nation? He disrespect you. Go after him. Why you want to kill everyone? If one black person did something bad to you, you have to kill all black people now? If one Arab did something bad, you have to kill all Arab people? One Chinese did something, now you kill all Chinese? What's the connection? There's good people, there's bad people everywhere. Every normal person understands every person is a whole world. Some people are good, some people are bad. The bad people can turn into good if they get the right education. You know, Adam, the first Adam, he gave names to all the animals. He named the animals. Who named him Adam? He came from the Adama. Adama. Himself. He named himself Adam. First name in the history of a human being was given to a human being by himself, not by his father. All the people, their parents called them their names. But he called himself Adam. He called all the animals, and the names of the animals are brilliant. It's no coincidence. Why he called the horse Sus? Sus. Why? Sas lakrav. He's happy to go into the battle. Why he called Nachash, Nachash? Snake, Nachash. Nach, chash. It's two words. Nach, first he rest, then he hurry. First step, he pause. Before he attack, he come. Then he pick up his head, he pause. Second or two, and boom! Before you realize, you need a slow motion 10 times slower to see that he moves. That's how fast he moves. Nach, first he pause, then attack. That's the meaning of the name, Nachash. Every one of the name, Kelev. Dog, Kelev. Why Kelev? Kulo Lev is fully emotional to his owner, like faithful to his owner. Lev, like with his feelings. He has feelings to his master. Kelev. All the names of the animals is teaching us about the nature of this animal. But in other languages, you don't have it. They decided to make a word, and that's it. The word doesn't have a meaning. We decided to call it a cat. Why cat? Because we were in a mood of C-A-T, whatever. Why? What do you want us to tell you? Dog. Why dog? Because today we thought about 500 words. One person say this, one person say, in the end you say, you know what, your word, it sounds beautiful. Okay, from now on you dog. Horse. What's the connection? No connection. We have to make names. So we pick up names. But in the language of the Torah, every name teach about what you're talking about. That you don't have in any other language. And then it says like this. So Adam called himself Adam because he was taken from the earth, from the ground. But the question is, every animal was also made from the sand. The body of the animal, a chimpanzee, is 99% the same DNA like a person. The body of a monkey, the body of a person, almost the same. Muscles, ligaments, every heart, kidney, whatever, same thing. Brain, eyes, almost the same machine. No, so why he doesn't call the animals Adam? They also came from Adama. Why only name himself that I was taken from the ground, but no other animal in their name you see an indication that they also came from the ground? Why? Did you ever think about it? What's the difference? All the other animals, it's irrelevant where they came from. They're not in a test. They don't have to remember I came from the sand. I don't have an obligation to be humble, to feel that I'm nothing. The animal can be proud. The animal can do whatever they want. They can be cruel, they can be proud, they can make a show off, the peacock open his feathers. It's not a sin. But me, I don't have permission to brag, to be a show off. Ego, pride, that's a big sin. Very big sin. Very big sin. Every time I'm about to brag, what's the first thing I have to remember? I came from the ground, a bunch of sand. That's who I am. And I will go back to the ground. As Kohelet say, you came from the ground, you will return to the ground because you came from there. That's the transaction of death. The spirit leaves the body and the body goes back to the ground. That's where he was taken from. It's a verse in Kohelet. So when a person remembers, Da me'ayin bata, remember where you came from and where you're going to be ending in the end of your life, that the worms will eat you and you're going to be inside the ground, it will remind you what's the point of showing off. What's the point of all this temporary honor? That's not the purpose of life. But the animal, they can be proud. What's the problem? Let them make a show. Like the chimpanzee, the gorilla in the safari, come to his female and pretend he's a macho. It's not a sin. You can do whatever you want. But by us, it's different than them because we are tested every second. Noah planted a vineyard. Grapes. Then he made wine. In the time of Noah, before the flood, when you planted the tree, that day he was giving you fruits already. Don't have to wait 3 years, this, all these things. Nature was different than today. The weather was perfect. There was no hot, cold like today, storms, that, hurricane. Very good, very beautiful place. Only after the flood, all the laws, the physical laws changed. So Noah, the day that he planted the tree, the vineyard, the grape tree, already had fruit, already drank, got drunk, and Hashem said to him, you should have learned from the mistake of Adam. Why? Adam did the same mistake. God told him, don't eat from the tree. What was the tree? Etz Hadat. Right? What was the tree? Grape. That was the tree, grape tree. That's the reason why in Judaism every holy ceremony is with wine. Why? The world got spoiled, got corrupted from the wine. It started with the wine, with the grape. And we will fix the world with the mitzvot. Letaken olam b'malchut shaddai. Wedding, wine. Brit milah, wine. Kiddush, wine. Avdalah, wine. Every Pesach, 4 cups of wine. No orange juice. No whatever. Why? Whiskey. $1,000 a bottle. Better than a grape juice. $20 a bottle, $10 a bottle. No? $1,000, good bottle, 20 years old, There's all kinds of things, very expensive drinks. Why wine? Grape juice. Grape juice, you do kiddush. It's not about the value of the money. It's about the importance of the tree. Also, the grape is unique from all the other trees. You cannot mix it with any other seeds. It doesn't accept. There's no way to merge, to mix. Also, it's a soft tree. And to make wine, you have to step on it. The nation of Israel, the nations, the goyim, will step on our head for thousands of years until the world will come to an end. But the wine, in the beginning, you step on it, then the wine step on you. After you drink, it knock you down. That's the secret of the wine. That's why the nation of Israel is equal to the wine, the Torah say. Nimshelu legefen. You cannot mix the gefen with any other tree. The Jew is not allowed to marry any other nation. And also one more interesting thing. The grape tree can only grow if it climbs on a piece of wood. When they plant it, it's not going to grow. It's going to stay on the floor. How it's going to rise? You have to take pieces of wood. You take pieces and you stick in the ground. And then the grape will climb on the piece of wood. It's very interesting because just by that, you see the creator of the world. You have to be blind not to see God's supervision in the creation. If you plant the grape here, right here, and you put the stick right here, 2 feet to the left, the gefen, the tree, when it begins to grow, will always know to what direction to go. If the stick is only here, it will come here, and there's no other direction stick, it will always come to here. Then, if you put another stick, it will evaluate which stick is closer, and will go to the closer stick. And just when it's about to arrive to the stick, you take the stick out of the ground and move it to the other opposite side. It will make a U-turn and go, always searching for the stick. Why? He is looking for something to climb on. This is the nation of Israel. Without our history, we don't have an existence. We are relying on all the dead rabbis who passed the Torah to us from generation to generation with their books. A stick that you stick in the ground is a dead tree. A live tree has existence only if it climbs on the back of the dead tree. The living tree cannot exist without leaning on the dead one who was already here before. This is very interesting. Everything is little secrets here. So Hashem said to Noah, you should have learned from Adam. I'm angry at you. Why didn't you see what was the end of Adam that he started with this tree? So the Magid Miduvna, the Magid Miduvna lived like 250 years ago in the time of the Gaon Mivilna, and he was the greatest speaker in the world. Thousands came to hear him. He had a brilliant mind. He used to bring beautiful parables, which most of them he invented in his mind. A genius. So he gave a parable, a mashal about this situation. He says like this. One person got a bracha from a tzaddik. One person got a blessing from a holy rabbi. And when he went out of the meeting, the first thing the rabbi told him, when you leave this room, the first thing you deal with, you will have lots of success in. That was the blessing. Now you're here in my room. When you leave my house, the first thing you touch and deal with, the blessing that I give you will go for that cause. So he thought, the person, what's the first thing I should do? I should run home to my vault where I hide all my cash and right away hold the cash in my hands so the blessing will go on the cash instead of $500 will become $500,000. That's the blessing, no? So he runs home. He says to his wife, go quickly, bring me the wallet. In the middle of the day, his wife never used to him come home and ask for the cash. So, you know, women are curious. So she said, why? Why you need the wallet at 2 o'clock, 2 p.m.? So he said to her, listen, it's no time for questions right now. Just go and get the wallet. Now she got even more curious. So she begins to argue with him. So they're arguing for half an hour. And that was the end of their marriage. The success of the argument was so great. The blessing he gave him, the fool, instead of running quickly by himself and get the cash, he had time not to argue with her. So he wasted the blessing on that. Time is running out, and I know I have 5 more minutes. You should know one thing, in the life of a person can live here 120 years. 120 years. In these 120 years, he will have one critical minute that is the most important moment of his life. 120 years, millions of minutes, millions. There's one special minute, the minute of your life that will change everything. It could be when you're 10, it could be when you're 20, it could be when you're 40. Usually it will come when you're younger. One choice, one decision, and your life will never be the same. For good, or God forbid, for bad. There's no return. I always give this example. This depends who you marry. I give you 2 girls, very pretty, very rich, no fear from God, no modesty, no nothing. Not so pretty, not so rich, no, average, but very righteous. He looks at the beauty, he looks at the average, thinking, what am I going to do with this one? Look at this, where I go, it's a good show off. Thinking, what's going to come out of there? Okay, so she's righteous. No, so, but dear, I enjoy life. That's how he thinks. And he decides to go with her. That's it. Looked like a simple choice. They could marry her. Both of them were interested. He decided to go with her. Definitely, his life will never be the same. That's it. Even if he's going to make 1,000,000 times repentance later, he will never go back to the original path that he lost. There's no way to change. Why? This righteous girl, from the minute they'll get married, she'll wake him up early in the morning, bringing him tea, coffee, come, hey, go, Ms. Minyan, you're going to be late, go to learn. That's okay, I don't need jewelry, I don't need cars, I don't need mansions, I don't need vacations, I'm not into this nonsense. I want to build my eternal life. And when the children are born, she's a great mother, she raised them for Torah, she supports her husband, she likes to talk to him words of Torah, she encourages him, he sees the wife never give him hard time, so she builds him up. Because if she will go against him, eventually he will give up, he can't. It's very hard to go against your wife if she's against you. It's like a resistant, constant resistance. It's a battle. Constant battle. You know why when a person gets married, the Torah says that he is dismissed from the army for 1 year. If now he got married and there's a war tomorrow, they don't take him to war. Even if he wants to go fight, you're not allowed. Why? Naki yele beto. 1 year he has to be clean from assignment, has to be in a house, and build his future and relationship with his wife, because they just got married. They need an ear to establish the home. But I heard a nice joke. Hashem knew that after he gets married, he's going right into a war. So now he's going to send him to another war at the same time. He is already in a war. That's what's happening today. 1 week after the marriage, as soon as the parties are over, Ba'sheket acharei ha-se'ara, the silence who follow the storm. 1 week, wow, life is great. Everywhere you go, people hug you, kiss you, picture, come, perfume, every day, new outfit, over here, Queens, Brooklyn, Lakewood, Muncie, traveling, great food, no. Then the party is over. They move in. The problem begins. The problem begins, why? No one prepared them for marriage. They don't know what it is. They're stuck now. What are we doing now? How are we establishing a kosher home? Just, it's what, is a boyfriend or girlfriend? That's what it is, two roommates who are in love with each other. How do you build your future? How do you run a home? How do you even open a bank account? Some of them don't know. Nothing, every little thing. Nobody prepared them for marriage. And then a year later, the kids begin to come. No one knows how to be a parent. So one mistake leads to another. And life, it becomes a combination of thousands of mistakes, who one leads to another, who leads to another. 60 years of mistakes. And then before he dies, he says, my life was very bitter. My children will all became bad. All of them did this, all of them that. I'm divorced 4 times. I lost my money. I was sick. He's describing his entire life. And he's thinking, God wasn't good to me. I didn't have a good life. When in reality, God was very good to him. He gave him everything and he messed up. I can give you $1,000. You can buy eternity with that. You can destroy the world with $1,000. Think about it. With $1,000, it's enough you save one person and make him religious, and then he become a huge rabbi who make thousands of people learn Torah, and then tens of thousands grandchildren, and then hundreds of thousands grandchildren, and it's all for this $1,000 that you had. And on the other hand, you can take the $1,000 and casino is one thing. You can take the $1,000, go to Pakistan, buy a suitcase with a nuclear inside, come to a Chas V'Shalom place and blow up thousands of people, and then it's a chain reaction with their children, grandchildren. Cain killed Abel, Hashem blamed him for all his descendants. You can kill thousands of people or millions of people, like knocking down the twins. You have to pay for each family who got destroyed forever and ever. You can destroy the world. You can save the world with a few dollars. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives every person some kind of a talent. Some people have more talent. Some people have less talent. But there's not a person that can say he doesn't have a talent for anything. One person is handyman, he is good with his hand. One person is musician. One person is a very sharp brain. Everyone has some kind of a talent. One person can be a great doctor. Not everyone can be a genius, but he cannot be a doctor. Everything in medicine you learn, you get it right away. Theoretically, you're the greatest doctor in the world, but you cannot operate one surgery. Why? You're not able to cut and see blood and touch veins inside in the heart. It's not for you. You faint right away, right? So everything needs skills. Even to kill, you need skills. Not everyone can kill. You have to slaughter a cow. Do you know what a hard thing it is to do? Did you ever see a slaughtering of a cow? You eat, you enjoy your steak now, you make parties. Do you know how it started? Took a big mountain of meat, which is a cow, a few tons, and they take the cow. I have to knock the cow down, take a knife like this, cut the neck, and rivers of blood is flowing all over you. Tons of blood, not one or two drops. It's like taking a huge bucket, spill it all over. That's how much blood comes out. And then you see the head of the cow for about 5 minutes, the nerve. Well, you give me $1 billion, I cannot do it. Cash, $1 billion, I hold the knife, I faint. Right away. But some people, holy people, righteous people. Who do you think are these people who slaughter? Used to be great, holy people. Never made sins. Mitzvah, it's a mitzvah from the Torah to do it in the right way. But not everyone can do it. For that, you need a talent. To be a mohel. Mohel. To circumcise the babies. Looks like nothing. It's a small operation. It's not so simple. I know a father. He wanted to be a hero. So all day, the Moel prepared him how to do like this. He teach him. When he give him the knife in his hand, he came to say the bracha. I see him like this. He's about to faint. He was about to, he realized now what he's about to do. He couldn't do it. Why? Theoretically, he was able to do it. When it came to action, he couldn't do it. Every person has, even to be a dentist, you think it's easy? Pull a tooth? It's also hard. Not everyone can do it. To drill and make implants. You know how hard it is? One little mistake, you go into the brain. To be an anesthesiologist, to give the shot in the right way. One extra you put a little bit, another gram in, the person is dead. And there's all kinds of complications. That's why $3,000 for a shot. You pay for the all male practice insurance because it's a very dangerous field. You need the talents. The world needs many different talents. Why am I saying this? HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent the person to this world. He puts a soul in a body, and a person has two things. One is talents and different things, and one is bad traits. This is what a person comes to the world with. Talents and natural bad traits. Personality issues. Everyone has personality issues. Some more, some less. And when you're born, if a person fixing his bad traits, because he knows that's the purpose of his creation, that God is putting him in a test to become a decent human being, to overcome his anger, his pride, his ego, his laziness, his stinginess, etc., etc., and he's focusing on a mission, then, and only then, he'll be able to take advantage on his talents correctly. Remember what I say here, I drop an atomic bomb here. If a person is not fixing his bad personality, is not addressing his issues, his anger, his whatever he is, and he still has, the talents are naturally in you. You're bright, so you're bright. You can be bright and be the biggest rabbi in the world. You can be bright and be the head of the mafia. They're also smart, these people. Cannot be the head of the mafia if you're stupid, no. Your brain has to work. Where to go, how to attack, how to rob, how to bribe, how to do this. You need to think. In every field, you need to be a genius. To be successful in almost everything, you gotta be smart. Cannot be a stupid person and be the head of the pyramid. Whether it's medicine, whether it's law, whether it's mafia, whether it's sport even. Even in sport, there is a lot of great basketball skilled athletes. But one become a giant star. Why? Because his brain is sharper than the others. He think one step ahead. Everyone else has the skills, but their brain is not sharp enough. They don't see. It's a matter of tenth of a second difference how his brain thinking compared to the other players. The extra tenth of the second make him a legend. Everyone knows how to kick the ball. Everyone knows how to run. Everyone is muscular. Everyone is working on their shape. But this little guy has a brain that works half a second faster than everybody else, and that makes a whole difference. He knows, he sees two steps ahead. Somebody begins to run, somebody runs over there, he already sees how he's going to do the connection faster, like a chess player. The more steps you can think ahead, the more advantage you end on your opponent. So why am I telling you this whole thing? So the skills can be on the talents that you came to the world with can only be to your advantage only after you first got rid of your mental sicknesses. Once you clean yourself from the spiritual cancer that you are born with, then you can cash and take advantage on the gift that God gave you when He created you. If you won't take care of your negative personality and your traits, your talents not only will not help you, will destroy you faster and bigger. Remember what I just said. If you remember this, then you will understand how important it is to change all these negative things that we have. Just yesterday alone, I spoke to a couple, nice couple, married for many years. From all the problems that they mentioned, all of them was one reason for everything. All the suffering that this couple is going through for so many years in their personal marriage, everything is from one sickness that the man has. What is it? He cannot manage and control his anger. That's all. If he had a way to control his anger, nothing would be bad in this marriage. Now this marriage is basically almost destroyed, 90% destroyed. Maybe we'll save it, but the idea is that if this person would correct his anger and will control his mouth when he gets angry, and he's control freak, he wants to control every detail, he wants to decide, he wants to force his opinion on her, he wants to be like a Nazi on her. I'm going to tell you what to do. It's not about being stingy. He's not going to give you money. He's going to go and spend thousands of dollars in a vacation. No problem. It's not having... Some people will never waste, never spend money, on themselves even. So they are stingy, no? But he's not like that. Generous, he'll give you, he'll donate, whatever he's going to do. But he's going to fight with you on $5 or $10 for the control that things are not done my way. That's a very common sickness. And when one of the two is with this kind of problem, marriage cannot be blessed, cannot. There's no way, no way to do it. There's no way in any partnership, two partners in the same business. One is control freak, wants to control, that's it. It's going to be an explosion. So one bad rate destroyed the life of the entire family, destroying it. Everything over there become bitter. Why, if he would take care of his anger, all the skills that he have would come out in a beautiful way. Now it's helping to destroy the situation more and more and more. This is a great thing to remember, Bezrat Hashem. So I said, 1 minute in life and your life will never be the same. One opportunity, you had it, you took it, you saved your eternity. You missed it, you damaged your eternity. You damage. Now, even if 20 years later you wake up and you become religious and you become serious and you fix things and finally, better late than never, like they say in America, better late than never, the answer is not always. Sometimes it's late, it's almost worthless because timing is everything in life. When you are 20 and somebody gives you a CD, and you watch a DVD, Torah and Science, and you wake up and you see, like today I got about seven emails just today alone. All of them, it's a copy, one of the other, with some minor changes. All seven people who wrote today, they say, I saw your film, or I saw this lecture, and it changed my entire life. Mamash, 7 emails like this today in 1 day. So these people who saw that, Baruch Hashem, it's 7 people who saw, and right when the film was over, moved into action, which unfortunately, it's rare. Most people go back to their phony life an hour later. These kind of people saw, digested right away what they saw. They knew it's a moment of a lifetime. If I take the opportunity now, I'll get saved. I wait a month, it will be all over. And they did something about it. One wants to come to yeshiva, one already doing that. One is married to Goya and he has children that are not Jews. So now he wants to bring the entire family to convert and his wife is willing already to keep all mitzvot. One CD that somebody gave him. One in Philadelphia, one in New York, one in a different state. 7 different Jews. So what happened here? This is an opportunity, a minute of a lifetime, that a person finished now the film and he has now this minute, the minute that comes right after. What am I doing with what I saw? If he decides to do right away something, his entire life will never be the same. If he waits 5 minutes, he goes back to pour himself some coffee, something, make a phone call or two. An hour later, he doesn't remember anything. 2 people saw. 1, 20 years later, became a legend, a great big tzaddik, rabbi, teach, makes millions of mitzvot. The other one stayed the same phlegmatic, the same fool. Nothing move out of him. They both saw the same opportunity. One grabbed it, one stayed the same loser he was 20 years ago. And it's not only 20 years, it's 2,000 years. It's not even the beginning of the outcome of one bad decision. One bad decision affects your entire future. Now, I know the way you think. You think What is he talking about? I have friends who became religious. What became greater in their life? Did they make more money? No. Did they become healthier? No. Did necessarily they get married right away? No. What is he talking about? Of course I'm not talking about this nonsense. I already said, this entire life here is a blink of the eye. Who cares about 40, 50, or 70 years? It's not what important. What important is the eternity. This world has to settle in the mind. It's either eternity or nothing. It's to lose or to win of a big time, not a one-time damage. You either win or you lose, and there's no in-between. You got saved, you save your soul, God puts you where you belong, and you're happy for billions and trillions of years. And if not, I don't even want to tell you the other side of the story. Believe me, it's not pleasant. And that's what it all comes down to. Moment of waking up, you take advantage of this moment, and you're on a roll. One thing leads to another. Forget about money, this, you make. Everyone, I didn't get married. What's going on? 10 years, today a girl called. 10 years I'm Baala Tshuva. 10 years I'm religious. She's still not married, in her 30s. So it could be 5 million different reasons. We don't know. We do not know. First of all, we don't know who you were in your previous life. Maybe you were married 4 times and you're a horrible wife to 4 of your husbands. And now a part of your punishment is to get married when you're very old or not to get married at all. How do we know? We don't know. We cannot be judges. We cannot be judges of others, and even on our own life we cannot judge. We don't even know 1% of our life. We don't understand our life. Do you understand why you missed the bus? Do you understand why you missed the flight? Do you understand why in the last minute the flight got canceled and you're stuck here and all kinds of things happen and you lost money and this? Do you know how many lives it saves? Do you know what you got instead? I once told you the story of the Rosh Yeshiva, who his wife was constantly telling him, why don't you go first class? You go from Israel every month to America to collect money for your yeshiva. Why don't you go first class? So he said to her, well, first class costs 4 times more. I don't want to waste charity money. I don't want to waste. So she said to him, no, that's not calling wasting. That's honoring the Torah. You are like a Sefer Torah, and you are representing the Torah, and it's not fair that you sit in economy like sardine. There's 2 ways to look at that. She may have a point, and he's going to say, better I'll be like sardine, that sanctify the Torah. And people say, look at this humble rabbi. He sit like a little sardine for 12 hours because he doesn't want to wait $3,000 on a comfortable chair. Depend. If you are smart, you admire him for sitting in economy. If you're a fool, you get angry. Why is not in first class? Depends what you are. If your mind is corrupted or your mind is clean. If your mind is horrible, then you'll say, why come? It doesn't matter. Like today I heard that the Rebbe from Satmer, he came to New York, and the security people, ask him to take all his clothes off. He has a long coat and all kinds of things. So all his servants who walks with him, you know, they say to them, that's a very important person. It's one of the important people in America. You cannot humiliate him like this. So the security guy say to him, I'm very sorry. A few weeks ago was Al Gore here. You heard about him? Was almost the president of the United States, and we make him take all his clothes and open up all his things. Over here, the rule is everyone get checked. Everyone. So if we did not give a special treatment to the almost president of the United States, definitely we're not going to give any respect to this rabbi, which we don't even know who he is. And even if we knew who he is, we can care less about him. And sometimes we wish he would die, because we are just another 2 anti-Semites. Assume they're not anti-Semites, that they're decent goyim. Why should they give him a special treatment? In their eyes, they do their job. So they made a whole scene. Big thing, they wrote letters to the security, they called the supervisor. Nothing helped them. The opposite, there was more embarrassment for them. So now, After that, they decided that from now on, he's going to fly only in private jets, which means they're going to spend every time he flies more than $100,000 to rent for him a private jet, that he won't have to take his coat and his shoes. Do you understand how dumb we became? Do you understand? Where this $100,000 going to come from? For people who donate to these people. I won't donate a penny to them. I won't. If I know, I always tell people, if you see someone knock on your door, first thing you check if he has a driver. If there's a driver waiting outside, don't give him a penny. Ask him, where are you from? Give me an envelope. What's your address? Next week, I send you a check. If I give you now something in your hand, the driver takes half or more. Why should I give this driver, which most of the time is just another criminal, why should I give him half of my charity? You didn't know that, right? Check. Half of the ones who knock on your door and crying to you that they have a problem, they have a driver waiting outside. The deal is, I take you to places where people give, and you give me half of the donation. If not, he doesn't know anything. Came from Israel, he doesn't know America, doesn't know where to go. He wants a driver to drive him all day. He has no choice. He has no choice, and the driver, the crook, takes advantage on the situation. So what you should do? Tell him, okay, I saw you have a yeshiva. Give me the address. Next week I'll mail you a check. I don't want to split my donation with this crook. But this is just one little tip. So here is a story that will teach us how it works. So his wife keeps telling him, take first class, take first class. And his heart is a kosher Jew. Doesn't let him waste money on first class. But then he heard that since you fly so much, maybe you can get an upgrade. So he went to the El Al desk. He said, listen, I'm flying every month, sometimes twice a month. Maybe you upgrade me. Why not? I'm a good customer. She said, why not, sir? Let me check. Yeah, I have a chair for you. Here, take me your chair. She gave him in business class. So now he sits in the front of the plane, beautiful, for free. Okay, for free, why not? Then next month, he flies again. You know, you taste, Ta'amuru kitov Hashem. He tasted, he saw Hashem is great. Okay, the chair is great, so he wants the chair again. So now he come, he asked them, you know, I'm a great customer, so maybe you upgrade me. Yes, sir, give me your ticket. Here. Mazal tov, shalom. Third time, he came, and they check and say, no, today the flight is full. What do you mean full? I have to find a place. No, sir, there's no room in business class. No, it cannot be. Call the supervisor. Half an hour argument. Supervisor came. Yes, what can we do for you? What do you want? People paid. You want us to get them on the flight to give you a free chair? We can. Today, you have to fly economy. Thank you very much. As he climb on the chair on the plane, he goes up. His face is Tisha B'Av. He's very depressed. Wow, why life is so cruel? So he goes with his bag, goes like this. One gentleman in business class, right, the way he got up, Rabbi, nice to meet you. What's your name? My name is such and such. An American wealthy guy. Oh, your son is learning by my yeshiva in Jerusalem. American boy. Yes. So the rich man say to him, Rabbi, I know what you're thinking. You've been sending me letters every year for 6 years to donate to your yeshiva. And you're probably wondering why all these years I never send you a check when I donate almost to every yeshiva who asks me for donations. He's well known as a philanthropist, you know. So the rabbi say, yeah, you read my mind. So he say to him, I'll tell you the truth. 6 years ago when you sent me an invitation to donate, I wrote you a check for $10,000. It was on my desk. And then another rabbi came to my office and talked to me about his yeshiva. And then he saw that I have a check ready for you. And he said to me, just, advice from you. I don't understand why you would like to give donation to a person who flies business class. You don't care about your donation, that it goes to the garbage. You want to donate to the Torah, no? So I said, yes. He said, in my own eyes, I saw that rabbi fly business class. Not once, twice, I saw him. So when I heard that, I ripped the check. But now, in my own eyes, the rich guy said to him, in my own eyes, I see you walking into economy. So hold on. Took his checkbook, 6 years retroactive, $10,000 each year. He wrote to him a check, $60,000. He said, that's what I owe you. And he gave it to him. True story, it happened a few years ago. Few years ago, fresh. These people are still alive. And he walked in. That's the story. What do we learn from the story? We sometimes get candies here. House, car, servants, a job, fame, all kinds of candies. But one thing we never know, how much we have to pay for this candy, we don't know. The bill is unknown. I'm not talking about the few dollars you have to pay for the car or whatever, no. The real bill. How much the real bill will be, we don't know. This rabbi, if he would get a chair in business class that day, this wealthy man wouldn't even say hello to him. He doesn't know who he is. He would sit the entire flight. The rabbi would feel great. I saved again $2,000 or $3,000 on a ticket. I got a chair for free. He feel great, happy. I'm a lucky guy. I get bargains. I get chupars, I get deals, all kinds of things like this. And he would not know ever that he lost $60,000, and perhaps he continued to get $10,000 every year until today. It could be already $250,000 of dollars. It could have been. He will never know. When he will know, when he comes to his tribe, and they will show him that day. And they show him how happy he was when he got and sat in business class. And then I said, this business class, you think you saved $3,000? You lost $200,000. What? $200,000? That was the bill. And they show him what would happen. And guess what would be his reaction? He'll kill himself. That's what life is all about.
Not his wife?
Huh?
Not his wife?
Ishto ke gufo, Gabi. The wife and the husband, once they get married, they're one team, for good and for bad. However, if one of them see that the other one is not serious, that's not a permission for them to go down in their spiritual level, like some women think or some men think. What do you want? My wife don't let. Don't let? She has a problem. She's going to save you from hell? No. She won't be able to save you from hell. She will have her own problem. I promise you, when the trial begins, she won't remember she was your wife. She will be drowning in problems up to here. She won't have a minute to think about you. Adam and Eve, a minute after the sin, Hashem comes to her. What happened? She blamed the snake. Who comes to Adam? Right away, he sold her for a minute. It's her fault. A real man. He tells the police, my wife gave me the idea to buy drugs. He goes down by himself, no? What did he gain by putting her down with him in a police truck? What's the point? Right away, blame her. Why? The fear was so tremendous from God. It wasn't downtown Manhattan that they just fall asleep in the middle of the trial. It's Hashem comes to you and says, where are you, Adam? Imagine the moment. His blood froze. Did you eat from the tree I told you not to touch? It's her. It's not me. It's her fault. That's why I always tell people, you buy stolen merchandise, you think I save money. Think again. When the police catch the crook, the thief, what do you think the first thing is going to do? Tell us who you sold to. They want to know. They want to put 50 together. They don't want to catch one. They want to take the entire thing. Also the drug dealers. He works for a big drug dealer. He makes a lot of money, this young guy. When the drug dealer will be caught by the FBI, they ask him, tell us all the list of people who work for you. You go down with him. Everything illegal you do, and you think you get away with that, you are in the hand of the person who was your partner to the crime forever. If you got lucky and 40, 50 years you lived here and he didn't get caught, no, so you got away with that. But most likely, all the things you do, one of them will get caught one day. And when they get caught, You go down with them, because the first thing they tell them, you are facing 20 years in prison. You want to sit only 5-6 years? Give us names. Kadima, the more names you give us, the more discounts we give you. That's how they do. Even if you did nothing, you're only the secretary. He'll push you in the deal. Why? He wants to get a discount. That's the way it works. The Torah would not permit a crook to testify on others. Someone who's facing execution and wants to save his execution by giving other names, the Torah doesn't permit that. A murderer cannot be a witness. Mechalel Shabbos cannot be a witness. So if you think your wife, you're going to be able to say, it's my wife's fault, it won't help you. If you think that you're going to say, it's my husband's fault, he didn't want to go to pray, he didn't want to go to learn, because of him we were half religious. If I had a better husband, I would be a lot more religious. This is all baloney. None of this will work in the time of the sentence in the court of heaven. None. You're not going to be able to say, it's my parents' fault, it's my brother's fault, it's my roommate, it's this. It's all baloney. There's nobody to blame besides yourself. Every person who wants to save himself is 100% in his hand. Yes, he can find excuses from here until the end of the world. But in the end, Hashem would say, listen, when it was really important to you, you did it. Even though there was pressure from the other side not to do it. Why? Because it was important for you. When you wanted to buy a car, he wanted to buy a cheap one, and you wanted to buy a very flashy one. And there was a battle between you and him. But you didn't give up. Why? You wanted a $50,000 car. You didn't want a $25,000 car. You made a whole show, a whole scene. You ran out of the house to your parents. I'm not coming back until you get me what I want. But when he doesn't want to go learn Torah, you sit and drink your coffee with your newspaper. Moshe, go learn Torah. I'm not in a mood. Okay. Why now you're not making a scene? Because the car is important for you. Your jewelry, it's important for you. I knew a family that the maid that was listening to my tape, she became religious. And she told me one time, you know what? This woman, this princess, that she has such fleshy life, she know the husband abused the boy non-stop, destroying him. But she pretends she doesn't see because she's afraid to lose her jewelry and vacations and maids. So she sell her son to destruction. I won't be surprised if he'll kill himself, the boy. Just that she won't lose one of her five maids or whatever. That's how selfish a person can be. His own children. That's it. And divorce cases? Most people take the money before they take their children. They're willing to put the kids on the street. Why? He wants to punish the wife. But your four children suffer. She won't get a penny. But your children will suffer. The children will be destroyed. There are four against one. This cruel Nazi, he wants to punish his wife. He doesn't care. He'll bury the four children with her. How many times you heard a bitter divorce case that he went and killed all the children and her and killed himself? Why? Why the children has to die? You want to kill her. Why you kill the children? I won't have them, you won't have them. But what about their life? Doesn't care about them. He only care about his ego and his selfishness. That's why if a person doesn't clean his negative traits, every talent he has become a poison in his life. Once he cleaned the cancer, what is it like? A bucket. If the bucket has burn oil in it, drops of burn oil, engine oil, and now you put lots of water, put a whole bucket of water into it, the oil, the burn oil, contaminate the entire water. It's all become black. Well, it's five quarts of water, but they're all dirty. Cannot drink it. Why? There's five drops of horrible oil or mud. There, you can't drink it. You have to clean the dirt from your system.
So what is the Trufa Lamakah?
The Trufa Lamakah, oh, thank you, Rachamim. It's important. Maybe the most important thing I did not say. And we'll finish with this. The most important thing is, it's much more important to learn every day Musar, ethics, than to learn Gemara and to learn everything else you can think of. Yes, The Torah says that after you know the general Torah, you should learn Talmud all your life. It sharpens the brain. It's the highest difficulty of learning. It's true. But most of the Jews, at least the ones I meet everywhere for 17 years, are first of all not in a level of learning Gemara. And they are working people. And for working people, it will take 20 years to understand Gemara to the lowest level. Why? It's an hour a day, 2 hours a day. You're not really getting anywhere. In the meantime, this is a very critical hours who go almost completely to a waste. Why? If this individual will learn at least an hour a day ethic, path to the just, Pirkei Avot, ways of the righteous, Pele Yoetz, there's hundreds of Musar, strong Musar books. Every day, it will make you a righteous person. However, if you learn even all day in Yeshiva, 20 years Gemara, and you're a great speaker, you're a genius, you know all the angles of the sugiyot and everything. But you never learn Gemara, 20 years later, you're still full of ego. You're still lazy, still arrogant, you still look at people down, you're still stingy, you're still everything. The same thing you were 20 years ago. The only difference is now you have a serious backup to back you up because people bow down to you because you're a great genius. 20 years ago, you were a total fool. No, so people knew who you are. But now, you're a shining diamond from the outside, but inside you're totally rotten. Same person. Believe me, it's better to be a fool with bad midot than a genius with bad midot. Why? He will steal $100 here and there. A genius will steal 100 million. He won't settle on 100. His brain is working. How to do, who to kill, who to bribe, what alarm to put off. Fraud, computer, FBI, Interpol. Doesn't steal $100 from people's pocket. The sharper he is, he uses it for more negative things. That's why it's very dangerous. That's why you should know one thing. The Torah brings a story that when Rabban Gamliel was fired from being the president, they replaced him with Rabbi Elazar. When Rabban Gamliel was the president, it used to cost money to come to yeshiva. He put a guard there and he say, only decent people are allowed into the yeshiva to learn Gemara. Someone who we know him that is not a decent person, not honest, not modest, not watching his eyes, etc., doesn't live holy lifestyle, I don't want him in yeshiva. So the yeshiva was more than half empty. The benches was more than half empty. When one day he had the argument there and he had to quit, and they nominated a new rabbi, he said the yeshiva is open for everyone. And the yeshiva became full. And the first rabbi, he got very upset. He said, maybe I made a mistake. Maybe after all, quantity, it's also something. Okay, there was less quality, and maybe I should allow another 200-300 learners, so it will be quality. And they show him a dream from Shamayim. No, you are right. God is not looking for quantity. He looks for quality. It's better that decent, clean people would learn than millions of corrupted people would stay the same thing. That doesn't help. Pride, ego, show off, all these things. That's why, if Rabbi remember, last week I say here that people who do mitzvot with ego and pride, none of their mitzvot count. So the rabbi asked me after the lecture, what about mitoch shelo lishma ba lishma? If a person does a mitzvah not for the sake of heaven, if he repeats it constantly, the Torah say, eventually, slowly, slowly, he will become for the sake of heaven. In the beginning, it's for money, for honor, for this, for that. He wants to get married. He has his reasons. But later, after he did it 500 times, he eventually will do it for the truth. And Hashem had mercy on me. When I drove home, I thought to myself, it's a very good question. And right there, I put on my way home a CD. I'm listening. Just when I got to my driveway, the answer was right there. What does it say? The Rambam, not me. The Rambam said, someone who learned Torah for kavod, for honor, to be a big shot, will never become a learner for the sake of heaven. This word, mitoch shelo lishma ba lishma, does not apply for someone who learns Torah for ego. Someone who learns Torah for ego will die as a learner for ego, will never become for the sake of heaven. Other things, yes. Learning, never. The learning in no purity with such horrible reasons will never become purified. First, you have to make yourself a humble person. After you correct that, then your Torah will be much more clean and much more pure, etc., etc. Thank you very much. We'll see you all. Bezrat Hashem, next Monday I won't be here. Next Sunday I'm going away. So next Monday there's no shiur. The following Monday we back. Is always check in the schedule, in case in the day of the lecture. Always check in events in my website if the lecture is as usual or not. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen.